Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the administration, the faculty, staff, and fellow students of Northwestern State University, I want to welcome you to your 2015 New Student Convocation. At this time, I ask that you remain standing for the presentation of the colors by the NSU Army ROTC Color Guard, the Demon Battalion. Cadets Lucas Schenk, Schaefer Kimball, Kashira McKnight, and Donette Stokes. The national anthem will be sung tonight by Leanne Munoz, Hannah Johnson, Billy Gore Jr., and Denzel Dawson. And our invocation presented by Mr. Matthew Whitaker, your NSU Student Government President.
Can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled
please bow your heads with me. Dear eternal God, I pray that you watch over all of those who have joined us in such a momentous occasion tonight. May you impart wisdom into our minds and peace in our hearts. I ask that as we move through this fun and exciting academic year, that you protect us and keep us safe. Grant our faculty the inspiration to touch the lives of our students while creating a safe haven within the classroom. Please bless those who continue to share in your miracles, and through your inner workings, may you help make Northwestern State University all that we know it can be. It is in your name that I pray. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. At this time, it's my privilege to introduce to you the academic leadership seated before you here on stage. You know, without these next few people I'm going to mention, everything you see here at this university would not be possible. So if you don't mind, if you're on the stage, just please standing whenever your name is called so that the students may put a face with the name. First, to my left, actually let me grab the list that has the names on them. First to my left, Faculty Senate President Dr. Massimo Bezzuari. To his right, First Lady of Northwestern State University, Ms. Tanya Henderson. The President of Northwestern State University, Dr. Jim Henderson. Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs, Dr. Lisa Abney. Vice President for University Affairs, Dr. Marcus Jones. Vice President for Technology, Innovation, and Economic Development, Dr. Darlene Williams. Vice President for External Affairs, Mr. Jerry Pierce. Vice President for Business Affairs, Mr. Carl Jones. And the newly appointed Vice President for Student Experience, Dr. Chris Maggio. To my right, your Dean of Students, Ms. Frances Conine. The Dean of the Gillespie Family College of Education and Human Development, Dr. Vicki Gentry. The Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, Dr. Steve Horton. The Dean of the College of Business and Technology, Dr. Margaret Kilcoyne. And the Dean of the College of Nursing and School of Allied Health, Dr. Dana Clausen. I'd also like at this time to recognize the row behind them, which are department heads and faculty leadership. The department heads, would you please rise at this time and be recognized? And then also seated before us here on these fourth and fifth rows are the faculty and staff of Northwestern State University. Please rise and be recognized at this time. It is now my distinct pleasure to introduce a faculty member with almost as much energy as Dr. Henderson. Pia White is a professor of theater, managing director, and associate artistic director of performance and directing concentrations. Originally from British Columbia, Canada, she's been at Northwestern for over 7 years. I now introduce to you Ms. Pia White.
When I was asked to be a keynote speaker for this affair, I must say I was flattered and honored. When asked what I should speak on, I was told to comment on the reasons why students should come to Northwestern State University. This question brought me back to 2003 when I came for the on-site interview here and was picked up at the airport by Professor Scott Burrell, and I asked him why he had stayed at NSU. At that point, he had been here for 5 or 6 years. And his reply was simple, because of the students. I loved that. Now, after having been here for 12 years, it's okay, 12 years, it only feels like 5 or 6. After having been here for 12 years myself, I understand. Our students are amazing. Yes, this quaint little town in the middle of Northwest Louisiana is beautiful. Relatively no crime, relatively no pollution, relatively no traffic, except for the lunch rush, which lasts about 10 minutes, and the Christmas fest, which lasts a weekend or two. But we are here because of you, our future. But really, when asked why you should come here, why you should stay here, I realized quite simply, it is because of us, the teachers. We are here to guide you, to mold you, to help shape you to be the best that you can possibly be, to see you for who you truly are. Most of you are coming here away from your family, away from your friends, away from your tribal council, feeling alone. But please know you're not alone. There are people here for you. Often, as I work in the theater and dance department, we rehearse after school, on weekends, throughout the school's break. I spend more time with my students than I do with my own children. This university is here for you. There are people who can help you through the hard times and rejoice with you in the great times, but we need you to bring 100%, 100% of the time. You do not get a do-over in this life. This is it. So why not make it the best that you can be? I'm directing the musical Rent this semester, and I'm constantly finding life lessons throughout the musical, as there really is no day but today. If you believe in reincarnation, great, but who knows? You may come back as a squirrel, right? Who doesn't have the opportunity to go to college? So this is it. Study, go to class, ask for help if you need it, offer help if you see someone struggling, work hard. Yes, party hard too, as this is college. However, you need to work harder than you are partying. You are here to gain an education, and we are here to support you, to encourage you, to push you in that quest. I love working here. I love teaching students that want to learn. I think we all do. It is much harder for us to grade a C or a D paper than it is to grade an A paper. So ask for help. Let us help you find the help. I encourage you to introduce yourself to professors so you're not just a number, especially in those large classes where you sit at the back of the auditorium and 100-plus students. Be someone. Walk down after your first day of class and introduce yourself to the professor. Shake their hand, look them in the eye, and be someone. Let us know you so we can help you, so we can empathize with you, so we can rejoice with you. We are here for you. We are your teachers. We are your lifeline. We are your ability to make it or break it. When asked to speak at this event, this welcoming of our future, I was reminded of an excerpt from Taylor Mowley's stand-up, which goes like this. He says, the problem with teachers is, what's a kid going to learn from someone who decided his best option in life was to become a teacher? He reminds the other dinner guests that it's true what they say about teachers, that those who can, do, and those who can't, teach. I decide to bite my tongue instead of his, and I resist the urge to remind the other dinner guests that it's also true what they say about lawyers, because we are eating, after all, and this is polite conversation. I mean, you're a teacher, Pia. Be honest. What do you make? And I wish he hadn't done that, asked me to be honest, because you see, I have a policy about honesty and butt-kicking, which is, if you ask for it, then I have to let you have it. You want to know what I make? I make kids work harder than they ever thought they could. I can make a C-plus feel like a Congressional Medal of Honor, and I can make an A-minus feel like a slap in the face. How dare you waste my time with anything other than your very best? You want to know what I make? I make kids sit through 40 minutes in study hall in... No, you cannot work in groups. No, you can't ask a question, so put your hand down. Why won't I let you go to the bathroom? Because you're bored and you don't really have to go, do you? You want to know what I make? I make parents tremble in fear when I call home at around dinner time. Hi, this is Professor Wyatt. I hope I haven't called at a bad time. I just wanted to talk to you about something that your son did in class today. He said, leave the kid alone. I still cry sometimes, don't you? And it was the noblest act of courage that I have ever seen. I make parents see their children for who they are and who they can be. You want to know what I make? I make kids question. I make them criticize. I make them apologize and mean it. I make them write, write, write. And then I make them read. I make them spell definitely beautiful, definitely beautiful, definitely beautiful, definitely beautiful, over and over again until they will never misspell either one of those words again. I make them show all their work in math and then hide it on their final drafts in English. I make them realize that if you've got this and you follow this, and if anybody tries to judge you based on what you make, you give them this. Let me break it down for you. Thank you. Let me break it down for you. Let me break it down for you so you know what I say is true. I make a difference. Now, how about you? Thank you. So now I will introduce our next keynote speaker, which is S. Dwayne Johnson. Dwayne Johnson is a 1996 graduate of Northwestern State University and currently resides in Los Angeles, California. His background in the sports marketing and hospitality industry spans over 15 years, having worked at 8 Olympic Games, the World Cup, Paralympics, the US Open, the Masters, and now 2 Special Olympics World Games. Prior to this, he has worked with productions that include the Academy Awards, the Daytime Emmys, the ESPYs, the American Idol Finals, and other entertainment events. I'm starting this off just like it's nothing, right? While earning his BS in advertising advertising design at Northwestern. Dwayne was involved in the Student Activities Board, Theta Chi Fraternity, Order of Omega, Freshman Connection, and was named Mr. NSU in 1995. Dwayne hails from Jenna, Louisiana, where his parents still live, and he makes it back to Natchitoches every Christmas to see the lights and to visit his sister and his nieces and nephew, who are destined to be future NSU demons. Ladies and gentlemen, future graduates of Northwestern State University, I introduce Mr. Dwayne Jones.
Thank you, Pia. I can't tell you what an honor it is to be here today. I am, it's really exciting and a little nerve-wracking to be back. I gotta tell you, a number of the people on the stage I know from my time here, 91 to 96, took me 5 years. For an art degree. I am really excited to be here and to congratulate you as the freshman class of 2015 for Northwestern State University, and to welcome you to this new student convocation. So I just want to tell you how excited I am. And we didn't have new student convocation whenever I started at Northwestern. I remember walking onto the campus, though, and I remember the excitement and a little bit of trepidation and not really knowing what to expect and exactly what was ahead of me. But I knew there was a lot of excitement, a lot of opportunities, and a lot of things for me to learn. And I really quickly learned that there were a lot of options on campus for me. Pia talked about some of the things that I was involved with at Northwestern while I was here, and they were things that really kind of helped me move through my college experience. I learned the options, everything from student activities to student government to athletics to academic organizations and so much more. There's really something for everybody here, and that's one of the things that made my college experience such a really exciting time. I learned probably as much outside the classroom as I did inside the classroom, and I always have to be careful saying that with all of the academics around me, but it is true, and I think most of them would tell you that exactly like what Pia said, you study hard, but you also find those other opportunities to sort of extend that experience for yourself. The experience I gained through student activities and through my fraternity with planning events and bringing entertainment to the campus really sort of helped lead into what I do now with special events and entertainment. And it really, really led into the experience I recently had. I've had some great experiences in my career, but what really just started for me over the last couple of years was working with the Special Olympics World Games that came to Los Angeles this year. It was probably one of the most difficult positions I had on the Games Organizing Committee, but one that was a real labor of love for me. I learned so much through that. The Special Olympics World Games was the largest sports and humanitarian event anywhere in the world this year. It was the largest event in Los Angeles, where I live, since the 1984 Olympics. And we had about 7,000 athletes from over 170 countries from around the world, about 3,000 coaches, and about 30,000 volunteers and over 500,000 spectators coming in. And I had a chance to really work on the organizing committee for that, and I fully drank the Kool-Aid, I gotta tell you. I got right in there and learned everything I could about people with intellectual disabilities and what Special Olympics does for these athletes, their parents, their supporters, their families. I also learned a lot about acceptance and inclusion, which is really the overarching theme for Special Olympics. So whenever I was asked to speak here today, I was really trying to figure out what could I possibly say to these new students. And it became pretty clear that the athletes could sort of teach me what I needed to share with you. There are a few points that I thought would be important and things that I would have liked to have heard coming in as a new student. And the athletes that I met through the Special Olympics World Games really sort of helped me help embody those points. So with that, I give you everything I needed to learn, everything I needed to know I learned through the Special Olympics World Games. So the first thing I would say is don't let other people define who you are. You are coming onto the campus as a new student, and you come with very different backgrounds. Many of you come from a very small school where you're a big fish and you really sort of were the leader of the pack. Others of you come from a large school where it was a much different situation. And some of you may have come from an opportunity or a situation where you weren't really thrilled with what your high school experience was. Well, what I'm here to tell you is that you're here now. You get to start over, and it's a clean slate. You get to define and tell everyone here who you are and what you're about. And that's the best gift you'll ever get. It really is. Because nobody here can define who you are except for you. You're not confined to whatever reputation or circumstances that may have been a part of your high school experience. You really get to set it. And the two words I would say to you is do you. Make sure that you sort of set that expectation of what people can expect from you and who you really are. So one of the people that defines this best for me is my friend Debbie. Debbie is, she was diagnosed at age 2 as communicatively handicapped, and later, when she started school, as mentally retarded. We don't use that language anymore. We now say intellectually disabled. But imagine what her parents felt whenever they heard this news. What will my child experience? What will their life be like? It can be somewhat devastating, and especially back then when there weren't as many resources around. Well, I'm going to tell you what kind of life Debbie has had. She started competing about 14 years ago in Special Olympics. And she competes in softball, track and field, and gymnastics. She's won over 25 gold medals. She's now on the board of directors for Special Olympics Southern California and for the Special Olympics World Games that were held this year in LA. She was featured on the World Games Rose Parade float on live on TV prior to the Rose Bowl. She's also a global messenger for the World Games, and she speaks on our behalf to corporations all over the country. Corporations like Coca-Cola, Mattel, Bank of America, Toyota, and many others, huge corporations. And she speaks to these corporate entities and really talks to them about acceptance and inclusion for people in the workplace and in life in general. She was also featured on stage at the opening ceremonies for the World Games, which was July 25th, and it was broadcast live on ESPN around the globe. So she was on stage standing next to our president and CEO, which was a pretty incredible moment. And she sort of gave a moment to the athletes and spoke to them about what they could expect from these games. So if there's anybody who was ever an example of not letting other people define who they could be or what they could do, it was Debbie. I'm Facebook friends with her, and I can tell you that her life is pretty incredible. I follow her on Facebook, and I'm a little bit jealous of how exciting the things she gets to do. So what I would say is, in terms of not letting people define you, take the next 4 or 5 years and figure out who you want to be, what makes you tick, and really follow that through. Define yourself and let other people know who you are. Second thing I learned is find your passion. You're in a position here where there are lots of opportunities for you. That's not just a college thing. I think that's something everybody should be doing every day. Find out what drives you, what inspires you, and what's going to make you really feel the good, if you will. And find a way to give back. Eunice Kennedy Shriver was a visionary. She was the 5th of 9 children in a pretty prestigious and politically driven family. Her brother John went on to become the President of the United States. Her brothers Robert and Ted became U.S. Senators. And her sister Rosemary was born, she started a little slower than everybody else, a little slower to learn, a little slower to react to things. She had an intellectual disability. And her parents in those days didn't have the resources that are out there today, and there was a very different stigma attached to intellectual disabilities at that time. But Eunice Kennedy Shriver felt that her sister, Rosemary, was disrespected by society. So she set out to change that, and she ignited a movement. In 1962, she started Camp Shriver in her backyard. She invited people with intellectual disabilities over and had them compete in sports to see what they could do and not to focus on what they couldn't do as a result of their disability. Her goal at that time was to really sort of create an atmosphere where they felt safe and empowered. Camp Shriver grew into what is now Special Olympics, and in 1968 they held the first World Summer Games in Chicago's Soldier Field, and it has grown into a complete movement. She predicted at that time, she was never one to sort of back down from a challenge, she predicted that 1 million Special Olympics athletes would compete one day. Well, I can tell you that 4.1 million athletes compete around the world today, which is a pretty incredible feat, and I think she had no idea that it would take off the way that it has. So no pressure, But I would say now is the time to start thinking about what you're going to do and how you're going to contribute to society. And this is the perfect opportunity and the perfect place to figure out what that is. There are so many organizations on this campus who can support you, and there are ways for you to give back that you have no, you can't even fathom right now. There are so many philanthropic opportunities for you here. So find other things that make you passionate about what you're doing and really act on those. This is Marco. Marco is an athlete, a Special Olympics athlete. I met him right after I started at the World Games, and he told me his story. A few years ago, he walked into a community center in Los Angeles to take classes in tiling and flooring. He didn't have a hobby, and he thought this would be a good skill to have. And through that, he discovered a passion that he never knew he had. Marco started making these mosaics out of stone and tile and beads. And it's grown into a phenomenon in LA now. He started making these mosaics that have the World Games logo on them, as you can see in the photo. We've commissioned him now. He quickly became our artist in residence at the World Games, and he actually has the business card to prove it. He'll show you and make sure that you have one if you ever meet him. We commissioned him to make 150 of these mosaics for our top sponsors and our official partners for the games. And it's really opened up a whole new world for him. He is so passionate about what he does. And we all on the staff put our orders in for our own mosaic. I put mine in back in October. Now, I'm not going to say Marco's a ladies' man, but none of the guys on the staff have gotten their mosaics yet. And as you can see, all of the women on the staff have gotten theirs. And you think I'm kidding? There's a few more. They've all gotten their mosaics. I still don't have mine. So I'm a little jealous about that. But then this happened on top of that. Yeah, that's Eva Longoria, giving Marco a shout out at the opening ceremonies of the World Games, live on ESPN to the world. And I just saw on Facebook literally yesterday that he has made Eva a mosaic now, and she's even getting hers before me. And I know him. Well, she does now. She met him that day. So he's making them for tons of celebrities. So what I would say is never underestimate where your passion can lead you and what can lead you to finding what that passion is. So the third thing that I learned through this is be brave in the attempt.
In ancient Rome, the gladiators went into the arena with these words on their lips. Let me win, but if I cannot win, let me be brave in the attempt. Today, all of you young athletes are in the arena. Many of you will win, but even more important, I know you will be brave and bring credit to your parents and to your country. Let us begin the Olympics. Thank you.
That was the original World Summer Games at Chicago's Soldier Field in 1968. That is the Special Olympics athlete's oath. Let me win, but if I cannot win, let me be brave in the attempt. Be brave in the attempt. Those words are so powerful. And what it really speaks to is Special Olympics believes this fully. It is not about winning. It is not about winning. It is about the journey, not the destination. What I would say to you is winning is great, but it's really about the experience of competing. And Special Olympics athletes know that better than anybody. You come here with academic goals and career plans, or you're developing those or figuring out exactly what you're going to want to be. And it's great to have those goals, but I want to make sure that you savor the moment and really feel the experience and experience that as you're going through these next few years. Don't forget to really feel that. This is Dustin. Dustin works with me at the Games Organizing Committee for the World Games. He was born with an intellectual disability and a cleft palate, so it made it very difficult for him to meet people. People were reluctant to sort of come over and talk to him because he had a speech impediment. He stuttered and really had a difficult time communicating early on. He also had a pretty unstable family life. He moved from family member and household to household. But in 1996, he got involved with Special Olympics. He is an athlete who has learned so much about his self-worth through that experience. And Special Olympics actually saved his life. It literally saved his life. And I'm serious. We have a program in Special Olympics called Healthy Athletes. And what a lot of people don't know is that Special Olympics is the largest healthcare provider for people with intellectual disabilities in the world. At this summer's World Games, we actually issued We had thousands of doctors and nurses who were on a volunteer basis running our Healthy Athletes program. We issued over 1,300 pairs of prescription glasses, eyeglasses, on site, over 320 custom-made hearing aids, we conducted over 600 comprehensive dental exams, including crowns, root canals. So many of our athletes come from other countries where they don't receive that dental care, and many even here in the States. And we issued over 5,000 pairs of new shoes. Over 40% of the athletes who showed up were wearing the wrong size shoes. During Dustin's dental exam in Healthy Athletes in 2004, they found gum cancer that the dentist and the doctors told him that had they not found it within a month, he'd be dead today. So when I say it saved his life, there's no bones about it. It absolutely did. And he's been out there telling that story ever since. He's happy to share that story with everyone. He also coaches a Special Olympics basketball team. He's a World Games global messenger speaking on our behalf to corporations all over the US. But he's also a Special Olympics international global messenger. So he travels all around the world speaking on behalf of Special Olympics in general. He works with me on the GOC, the Games Organizing Committee, as I mentioned, and he books the other global messengers who speak. He literally does their scheduling. He also oversaw our uniform program for the 30,000 volunteers and staff that we had working at the World Games. He chose the uniform colors for everyone. He did the distribution process and really set all that up. Dustin represented us in Pyeongchang, South Korea, at the last World Games for the handoff of the flag as the World Games were getting ready to come to LA. And then he also represented us at the White House at an event hosted by the President and First Lady for Special Olympics. So he later, ESPN, our official broadcast partner for the World Games, reached out and this happened.
It's really a first for those of us at ESPN. This is our very first coverage of the Special Olympics World Games. But this is hardly the first opening ceremony for our expert commentator, Mr. Dustin Plunkett.
And Dustin has really done it all, a Special Olympics athlete for 19 years, an international global messenger. He has met presidents, sports legends, a senior executive role in the LA 2015 World Games. A year ago, we were invited to the White House for a Special Olympics dinner. And what a great 12 months it's been leading up to this moment, Dustin. What do you want us, the audience, to know tonight about this experience?
I want the audience to know about this experience and take it away that it's all about the athletes. These are the best athletes in the world in my mind.
So Dustin, this shy, timid guy who never wanted to speak to anyone, is now an on-air reporter, and they later changed his title to on-air commentator and analyst because he had special knowledge of the content that he was speaking about. So Dustin, if ever was someone who was brave in the attempt, he's the guy who demonstrates that for me, and he taught me so much about really fully experiencing everything that we do with those games. The fourth thing I've learned is to discover joy in everything. Our athletes know this better than anyone. I won't say a whole lot about this one because it's pretty simple, but when the GOC, the Games Organizing Committee, worked on our logo, they worked with our pro bono ad agency to develop our logo, there was a lot of thought put into it. And there's right in the center of that logo, there's a celebratory figure doing the celebratory pose of victory. That is something that you'll see our athletes taking advantage of and doing all the time. What it means in special, what you'll find in Special Olympics is that generally it could be the fourth or fifth person who crosses that finish line and they strike that pose just like they were the first one to walk across or to run across. It's not about that winning moment. It is really about finding joy in that experience. Studies show that people who are born blind and have never seen before, whenever they celebrate or whenever they achieve something, they instinctively strike that pose. And that was really part of our campaign and our message to people. Reach Up LA was our theme for the World Games. So this is a pretty incredible time in your life, and there are lots of opportunities and new experiences, but they won't all be easy. So I would encourage you, move through them, find some joy in that experience, and figuring out what that joy is not always an easy thing, but there's generally something there. You never know what kind of opportunity might come out of an experience that wasn't quite what you thought it was going to be. So this is Kaylee. Kaylee also works with me at the Games Organizing Committee. She's our receptionist in the office. She's also an athlete. She competes in about three different sports, including swimming. She's an actress, a singer, and she's a pretty all-around fun person. So if you walk past Kaylee's desk and you don't give her a hug, you're going to hear about it. I've gotten emails, I've gotten voicemails, because I was in a hurry running past her desk and didn't stop to give her a hug. So she is all about finding joy in every moment. This is Kaylee with some of her biggest fans. That's me up there in a photo with her, as well as Olympic gold medalist Greg Louganis and Louisiana boy Hunter Hayes. Hunter performed at one of our events this year, and this is one of my favorite clips. We put Kaylee on the red carpet a lot to speak to our celebrities because she's just so high energy and has such a good time, and she always makes them comfortable and lets them have a good time. And this is one of my favorite clips from her interview with Hunter Hayes on the red carpet.
How long have you been swimming?
Since I was 9 years old, actually.
Oh, wow.
So that's when I started with Special Olympics, too. Yeah. That actually helped me to overcome my shyness to other people.
Oh, wow.
As you can tell, I'm not now, but when I met you, I was. Like, oh, my gosh, is that the
And you don't seem shy to me at all. And I know the feeling because I was shy before I started making music. And then now that I've started kind of, you know, making music, I feel like I can be myself, right?
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah, totally.
Yes, thank you so much, Hyshel.
Absolutely, thank you.
You're the best.
Crazy K.
That's what?
Crazy KK. That's a wrap? Awesome. What a fun interview. I'm a huge fan of yours.
Thank you.
She had so much fun with that, and you could tell Hunter was enjoying it as well. She just made it fun for him. Kaylee doesn't let her disability keep her from finding joy in whatever she's doing, and she brings that joy to other people and makes them feel at ease in everything that she's doing. She also promotes acceptance and inclusion in everything that she does, whether she's talking to somebody on the red carpet, whether she's on her social media, or just interacting with people in general. Your time, as I mentioned here at Northwestern, is going to be filled with so much joy and a lot of great moments, but there are going to be times that may be a little tougher, so you got to find those joyful moments in whatever comes out of that and whatever direction it might help you steer in. You never know what challenge might turn into a new opportunity. And the final thing I learned was remember to always say thank you. This is a big one. This is a big one, and I think in today's society, things are moving so fast that it doesn't happen a lot. One of the most important things I can leave with you today is to remember to show gratitude. This is Jason. He's one of our athletes for Special Olympics Southern California. And I can tell you that anytime you have a conversation with Jason, anytime, he says thank you at least 15 to 20 times. It's like his thing. He's known for it. He wants to make sure that you understand how grateful he is for the opportunity to talk to him. To talk to you and to really share, talk about those things and really enjoy that moment. And he makes you have a good time with it. During the games, Jason was one of our ambassadors, and we used his image on a lot of posters and signage all over the city, which was pretty cool. And that happened with a number of the athletes that I've mentioned in the presentation today. He loved being an ambassador for us. This is Jason, who literally held court in the lobby of our host hotel, where you can see the big banner of his image. And he would just stop people and ask them if they wanted to take a photo with him because he's up on the banner. And he literally all day would just sit there, and he did the same thing in the convention center where that other banner was, and loved it, and people loved it. And every time he took a photo with someone, he thanked them for stopping to take a photo with him. This is me and Jason with during one of his visits to the office, and He thanked me after we took that photo. So I would say saying thank you is pretty important. I mentioned the faculty, the staff, the advisors, and everyone on this campus. And you heard from Pia and a number of others about the resources here available to you. They really will make this experience a completely full one for you. There were two people who really shaped my experience here. One of those was Liz Carroll. She was the assistant director of student activities when I came onto campus here. And she really became sort of my second mom during my time here. She taught me to always find joy in everything. And her motto, she worked with me in student activities, and her motto on everything was throw a little glitter on it. Make it shiny. They'll love it. They'll love it. So she really taught me that more is more, and make it good, and everybody will love it. Really made my experience here a full one. The second person who did that for me was Aretha Cox. Aretha invited me to speak at this event, and I wasn't sure exactly what I was going to say, as I mentioned, but she actually recruited me to attend this university. She recruited me, then she worked with me in student activities, and then she worked with me in Greek life. So she sort of she literally stepped through the entire college process with me. And both Aretha and Liz saw a lot of potential in me that I didn't often see, and they really pushed me to step outside my comfort zone. So I'll be forever grateful for that and for the opportunity to really to come back and thank them publicly in that way. So what I want to recap really quick, five quick and easy points. Don't let other people define you. Find your passion. Be brave in the attempt. Find joy in everything. And always remember to say thank you. These are things I wish someone had told me when I came here. And I think they're things that will ride with you throughout your entire experience here. And these messages were totally enforced by the athletes that I encountered during the World Games.
They came from all over the world, over land, over water, overcoming obstacles and coming to triumph, coming to win, to compete, to inspire, coming to be brave. They came to Los Angeles. They came to rise up.
You're broken down and tired of living life on the merry-go-round. You can't find a fighter, but I see it in you, so we gon' walk it out.
So now what I say to you is, it really is up to you. This is your time. This is your opportunity. I invite you to rise up to whatever challenges lie ahead and become that person and let these great people help you do that. There's nobody better equipped. Congratulations on being here, and thank you so much for having me back. I really appreciate it. So now,
you know, as earlier as we introduced the deans and the provost and everything, you know, I just want to clarify some of those terms, because really up here, you see seated before, we're going to introduce now some presentations to classes. But I want to let you know that the people seated behind me are what we call the president's leadership team, his academic leadership team. And really that defines what these faculty members are behind me so well. We're all a team here. We're one big demon family. And the faculty behind me are just as much a part of that as you are. So it's now my pleasure to introduce the people that really, that define this demon family and the leadership here at Northwestern State University, Dr. Chris Maggio and Ms. Frances Conine.
Ooh, first of all, I'd like to say, Dwayne, thank you so much. Thank you so much for what you bring and the way you represent Northwestern State University. I remember when he walked on this campus, and as he said, we didn't have a freshman convocation, but I do remember Dwayne as an outstanding student, and I made a statement about 20 years ago that Dwayne Jones was going to change some lives in this United States, and I was wrong. As you can see, he's changed lives all over the world. Dwayne, thank you so much. Pia, thank you so much for showing the passion that our faculty and staff have for our students at Northwestern State University. What'd y'all think? Pia, thank you so much. Students, graduating class of 2019. I just raised the stakes, didn't I? Graduating class of 2019, I wish that each one of you could come up here and stand and see the view that I have right now. This is awesome. This is why we do this. This is exciting. And I want you to remember that. I want you to remember this day, 4 years from now, when you walk across the stage as a graduate of Northwestern State University. And as Dwayne mentioned, coming from a rural central Louisiana town, as he did, with about 100 or less students in his graduating class, to organizing the world's largest event of 2015. It can happen, and it can happen with you. And we know it's going to happen. Folks, I don't know if you know this or not, but this is probably the first time in your life that you've chosen to go to school. I guess as the first 12 years, somebody was there to say you had to go to school, especially during your elementary years, and then when you got into high school, there was somebody there to wake you up, make sure you got out the door. But isn't this exciting that you have made this choice? You are furthering your education. It's your choice. It's your passion. This is your life, your career. Make the most of it. You were introduced to some of the faculty and staff, not only on stage, but out in the audience right here. And folks, I want you to be, and I know they will say the same thing, be inquisitive. Ask questions. The faculty love to be challenged. They love for our students to be engaged. And if you have questions or any concerns, not sure what to do, we're here for you. You're not by yourself. But I hope we get to the point where you're not just relying on us, that we will enable you, that you can make a lot of these decisions by yourself. But we know right now a lot of things are new. There's some reminders that I may have to give to you. My folks in the Academic Advising Center told me to remind the students to look at their schedule, not only the ones that they have that they were printed out at Freshman Connection, but go online to make sure some of the rooms haven't changed. You don't want to get to the wrong room tomorrow. Y'all remember that. Go online, because we may have had some changes on some of your classes. Rely on us. We're here to help you. That's what we're here for, and we like it. We love doing that. Students, challenge yourself. Be persistent. Dwayne mentioned it's not always going to be smooth. There's going to be some rough times, I promise you. But please know that we're here for you, we're here with you, and we're going to celebrate with you when you graduate in 2019. At this time, thank you. At this time, I want to hand and present to your Dean of Students, Ms. Frances Conine, who she and her staff will be there with you in a lot of different ways to support you outside the classroom, to help you through some of those tough times and a lot of those good times. But I want to make a presentation to her, and it's a brick for the class of 2019, and we're going to put this brick in the courtyard of the Alumni Plaza right outside of this auditorium. It's going to be the first brick for you all. And I challenge each and every one of you, as you get to your graduation, purchase one of these bricks with your name, your degree, your graduation year to go next to this brick, that you made it through Northwestern State University and you've joined the ranks of proud alumnus of Northwestern State University. Guys, Frances Conine, welcome the graduating class of 2019.
This is your brick. Welcome, class of 2019. It has become my tradition to share with freshmen the top five things not to say to your college professors. Today, I continue that practice. So, the top five things not to say to your college professors. Number five, Siri gave me the wrong directions to class. Number four, I couldn't come to class because I was stuck in the storage bin under my girlfriend's bed. That really happened, by the way. The number three thing not to say to your college professors, didn't I see you on Naked and Afraid last night? Number two, Twitter said class was canceled for the season premiere of Orange is the New Black. And the number one thing not to say to your college professors, I thought 50 Shades of Grey was on the freshman reading list. My job as Dean of Students is to advise you and to advocate for you. That means I will stand beside you in good and bad times. I might want to throw you off the bus, but I will never throw you under it. I am one of many people at Northwestern who will champion you. There is a deep tradition of kindness and support among Northwestern students, faculty, and staff. We protect each other, we help each other, we care about each other. Today, I prevail upon you to adopt this ethic of care. Our students do great things. You give me hope for a better world. You've heard and you will hear more about our traditions of service. And you can make an equally important impact on a personal level. You can be the college woman who tutors disadvantaged students in your residence hall. You can be the college man who stops your friend from taking sexual advantage of women when they've had too much to drink. You can be the college woman who confronts your classmates for harassing others with opposing political views. We are obviously a diverse community. We are Republicans, Democrats, libertarians, rich, poor, differently abled and gifted. We are male, female, LGBTQ+. We are black, white, Latino, Asian, and Native. We practice every major religion in the world, and some of us are not religious. We are different, but we are all demons. I challenge you to care. Get involved. Do not be a bystander. Care about each other, your faculty, staff, and this institution. Care about our world. Collectively, college students have power. You have helped stop wars. You have helped elect presidents, and you have influenced law and policy for our nation. Start now. Be a demon leader for a better world. And it is my pleasure to introduce two great demon leaders, Miranda DeGraw and Trey Nelson.
Get up on this stool here so y'all can see me.
Well, just to go ahead and clear up any confusion, because I know it's probably on everyone's mind, I'm Trey and this is Miranda.
And not the other way around.
Class of 2019, though you may not realize it, you are sitting in the same seats that thousands of Northwestern State alumni have sat in. People who have gone off and had huge impacts in this great state and amazing country. Each and every one of you has taken the first crucial steps to your adult lives and your futures. And for that, I want you to give yourselves a round of applause.
So, we didn't want to bore you with cliches that you hear about college all the time, like college is the best 4 years of your life.
And make the most out of your time in college.
When one door closes, another opens.
For every hour of class, there's an equal 3 hours of studying.
Put your best foot forward.
I know each of you has heard at least one of these cliches, because when looking at schools, I heard them all the time. No matter how many expectations you may have about college, the first year experience is different for every student. When looking at the first year experience, you can kind of separate it into two main categories. You see, you have students who come to college, and they write a new chapter in a book that's already being written. They already have a general idea of what they want to do in life, and they use the resources given to them in college to expand and prepare themselves for the real world.
And then there are the students who write an entirely new book. They leave the book they started in high school on the shelf at home, and when they get to college, start an entirely new one. These students take time to get a feel for the whole college experience and use that to mold their new identity. In high school, I was much different than I am today. I wasn't as outgoing, I didn't push myself, and I've kind of stayed in my comfort zone. People I went to high school with would never imagine that I would be up here talking to you about my college experience, although you may have to remind them who I am first. I stuck to what I knew, which was dancing. The only thing I was really involved in during high school was our dance team. And even though I wouldn't say I had a bad time in high school, it's nothing compared to the experiences I've had in college. After deciding NSU was going to be my new home, my first instinct to get involved was to try out for the Dazzlers, Palmliner, cheerleading. Well, that plan got ruined when I broke my heel my senior year. I guess I took the saying, break a leg, a bit too literal. I had no idea how I was going to enjoy my years here at NSU without having a team to get involved in. When I came to my freshman connection, I remember sitting in this auditorium, watching the connectors do their song and dance on stage, and my mom leaned over to me and said, OMG Miranda, that has to be you. Now, at the time, I just kind of blew her off and told her to stop saying OMG. Little did I know that being a freshman connector would be one of the most rewarding experiences of my college experience. After that day, I knew I had to make a change in my life. I had always known I could step up as a leader, but I was always just too afraid to do so. As crazy as it may sound, moving away from home, not knowing anyone in this small town, and breaking my heel was probably the best things that could have happened to me. I made the decision that I had to step out of my comfort zone, and I had to be one of those awesome connectors. And I started an entirely new book for myself.
And on the other hand, when I came to college my first year, which seems like so long ago, but was literally just last year, I had a general idea of what I wanted to do in life. One might even say I opened up a new chapter in my book. I was that kid who had the burning desire to become, yep, you guessed it, an archaeologist. It took me years before I even learned how to spell the word archaeologist, but I knew one day I wanted to be one. Because in my heart, I wanted to be the guy that got to climb the pyramids and find hidden treasure and dance with mummies. since that's what I thought they did back then. But everything changed when I took a trip to Washington, D.C., and I realized that politics was where my true passion was. Soon after, I started looking into universities that would aid in helping me achieve my goals and new academic ventures. I looked at the Louisiana Scholars College here in Northwestern and saw they had an awesome pre-law program. So I soon took the ticket, applied, got in, and started fall 2014. In high school, I was involved in a lot of organizations, and I had a lot of opportunities to get out there and meet people. And while I did have to give up my dreams of being chased by mummies and jumping over traps, I realized that college would give me everything I needed to prepare myself for the real world.
And that preparation started with the first semester. I still tell people, even as a junior, my first semester was my favorite of my college experiences. Freshmen have it made. Everyone is so willing to help you find your way and your place here on campus. You get pulled in every direction because everyone's just so excited to get to know you. You get invited to everything, which quite honestly made me feel super important. Come to Color Chaos. Are you going to Glow in the Dark Zumba? It's really easy to feel at home here at NSU, but it's also what you put into it. You have to make it your home. Like I said earlier, I completely stepped out of my comfort zone to make sure I had a good college experience. And I challenge you to do the same. Getting involved is probably the best advice I can give you. There's a club for almost anything, and if you can't find something you like, start one, because I'm sure there are others who are interested in the same thing. Of course, we are here for our academics and to achieve our goals of getting that degree. But getting involved is what's going to enhance your college experience. And these experiences are what's going to help you become the person you aspire to be. So whether that's writing a new chapter or starting an entirely new book, as long as you're creating those experiences, you'll love what you've written.
And what you've written these next 4 years is what's going to make you love this university. I'll tell you, the moment I got out of my car move-in day, I was immediately swarmed by tons of students who were eager to help me move in, which I'm sure many of you were in the past couple of days. I soon realized through Welcome Week activities and student support that NSU was a campus that cared about the student experience. You see, one thing your high school teachers might not have told you is that college is not just about going to class and making good grades. It's relationships, experiences, academics, memories, and feelings that are going to make your time here at NSU. The feeling of your friends inviting you to a random dorm party in the middle of the week, or the feeling of a teacher emailing you about an assignment that you missed because they genuinely care about you, or even the feeling of just sitting out on the Cane River and knowing in your heart that NSU is truly your home away from home. Let me tell you, these feelings were what I experienced my first year at NSU, and now it's time for you to make your memories. I had an incredible amount of opportunities my freshman year and got involved and was able to contribute back to the Demon family. And even though I was just adding another chapter to my book, there were still many pages in that chapter that needed to be filled with lessons. Opportunities linger around every corner of Northwestern for myself, you, and every student. Because once you attend Northwestern, you're wholeheartedly a part of our family.
And when we say we are a Demon family, it is nothing to be messed with.
We are not just a family that has awkward Christmas dinners once a year. We're a family that's united and a family that goes to class together.
Shares memories at the CAF together.
And even has questionable nights at the, you know. Well, you get the picture. NSU has one goal.
Yours. Because Northwestern State is a lot more than just another university, we will be your friends, family, laughs and tears for the next 4 years.
And to symbolize you becoming a part of our Demon family, you may now put on your 2015 Northwestern State University class pin.
Display your pin proudly as it symbolizes the rich tradition of loyalty, leadership, and service expected of a Northwestern State Demon.
To be a Demon. As a Northwestern State Demon, I will proudly exhibit loyalty to the traditions and activities of Northwestern State University by honoring myself, my institution, and my fellow members of Northwestern State family. By honoring my commitment to the pursuit of building knowledge and intellectual curiosity.
demonstrate leadership by engaging in the life and activities of the campus, both in and out of the classroom, and by contributing what I've learned here to the betterment of mankind.
Engage in service to my fellow man, my alma mater, my community, and my country, and encourage others to follow my example.
Please join us in finishing the student creed, which you can find on the back of your programs.
Guided by these principles of loyalty, leadership, and service,
I am now and forever a Northwestern State Demon.
You see, we've written our next chapters
and started our new books.
And now we challenge you to do the same. Fill your pages with experiences that will make you proud to be a Northwestern State Demon.
Thank you.
Honestly, this next speaker, I don't really know how to describe him or bring him up outside of talking about his character and who he is, really.
When he drives a car off the lot, the price increases in value.
His bedroom pillow is cold on both sides.
His mother has a tattoo that says, son.
He has inside jokes with people he's never even met before.
He once hosted a basketball tournament at his house on campus and threw the game just because he wanted to know what it felt like to lose.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the most interesting president in the world,
Dr. Jim Henderson.
Wow, thank you all very much. And welcome to Northwestern State University. This is a very exciting time for me because this is my first freshman convocation. They didn't exist when I started here. Of course, I didn't start here as a freshman. I was making a circuitous route to my college education that took a couple different paths. My dad said, boy, you need to quit working as much. You need to come to Natchitoches, go to Northwestern, finish your degree, and marry a Cajun girl. And I said, Dad, I ain't gonna do any of that, because that's how I spoke then, right, you know, before I got educated. And so I did. I moved to Natchitoches. I came to Northwestern. I was walking to Dr. Parrish's class, and a little girl came walking by in plaid shorts and a purple shirt with the sleeves rolled up. I said, holy cow, I'm going to marry that girl. And so there she is. Yeah. So just think, there could be somebody in this room. It's going to be very meaningful for you. But, you know, it's funny. I was asking Tanya, I said, you know what? I don't know really what I should talk to these folks about because they're going to sit through almost an hour already before I even get up. The Catholic's going to be ready to go because we've got that internal clock. You guys know what I'm talking about, right? 1 hour is time. Anyway, she said, well, just when you think about your college experience, what's the first thing that comes to mind? And I said, thank God there were no cell phone cameras. No Instagram. We were free. Seriously, when we had a nice meal, we had to take a picture of it, take it to the store to get it developed, wait 2 weeks, and then go hand deliver it to all of our friends so they could see it. Completely different world. You guys have it so easy. But I hope most of you are excited. I know some of you are a little nervous about starting. Keep something in mind, 95% or even more of the people that you engage on this campus have gone through what you're about to go through and they survived. We really did. But here's the funny thing, we don't want you to just survive, we want you to thrive. And that's what tonight was all about. There were a lot of symbols tonight, I hope you caught some of them. Some of them were a little more subtle than others. Some were obvious like the brick. Others were more subtle like the faculty senate president led us out in the procession. That's because the faculty are the most important people you will get to know on this campus. They have a wide variety of personalities and teaching styles, senses of humor or lack thereof. Engage them. Ask them questions. Trust them. Even those that may intuitively say, I don't know where this guy's coming from. Believe me, they're professionals and they're here for a reason. Trust them, engage them, communicate with them, follow them. They will lead you to success. Another symbol was the fact that our students took such a leadership role tonight. Hunter, Trey, Miranda, Matthew, they're extraordinary students. We use them as examples of what leadership is about. They have amazing futures ahead of them. But you don't even have to take a leadership role to be a successful student. Do me a favor, before you leave tonight, make a commitment that in the next 6 weeks, you will go to every single class on your schedule. Don't skip one, just for 6 weeks. When you do that, you're going to look around and you're going to see some people that are really stressed out because they didn't follow that advice. And you're going to think to yourself, really, college is not that hard. And it wasn't that difficult for me to do what I just did. So then commit to do it for the next 6 weeks. And by then, we're getting close to Thanksgiving. You're 3/4 of the way towards the end of the semester, and your finals will be a breeze. Promise you it'll work, because I have the experience the other way, right? The credit hours on my transcript are actually the number of contact hours that I sat in the classroom. I made it through simply because I decided to make my schedule what Tanya's was, and she took great notes, and it really worked well. You know, it's, what did Al Capone? Sometimes we laugh because it's funny and we laugh because it's true. Don't quote Al Capone, I'm sorry, I forgot. There were some other obvious symbols. You notice we're all wearing regalia, or most of us are wearing regalia up here. And we've been wearing academic regalia for about 1,000 years. Not us, but people have been wearing regalia for 1,000 years. And the United States has really kind of just become its modern form in about the last 100 years. And you notice we do it with different things. We have the school colors and the silks, and we have our discipline colors and the velvets. And you'll see these little chevrons here. This, mine is particularly different because it's a gift from the student body. See, my actual regalia is midnight blue, I think, and my collar is drab, and I have this beautiful blue and white in the back. That's what I wear when I'm representing my alma mater for my doctorate degree. But I have the great fortune of representing my alma mater, Northwestern State, as the president. And the student body gave me what's called presidential regalia. So that's why we have 4 chevrons on the sleeves. That's kind of cool, isn't it? It's cool for me because, anyway. Another visible symbol. We're going to have the picnic tonight when we leave here under the columns. And the students that set that up, it's absolutely magnificent. It's beautiful. But those columns, why are we going to be under the columns? It's because what those columns represent. They stood there since before the Civil War. Does anybody remember the Civil War? Where's Jerry? Jerry? You remember what I'm talking about? Wow, and he's over external affairs, right? Those columns have been there. They symbolize the tradition and the heritage and the permanence of Northwestern State University. It's huge. We have some symbols that you've heard in the music. When we walked out to the Imperial March, Darth Vader's theme. And I hope you caught the symbolism of that. What does it mean? It means Episode 7, The Force Awakens, comes to a theater near you December 18th. Is that just awesome? That was pretty cool, right? I'm so pumped. I can't wait. Tanya hadn't seen Episode 4 yet, but that was okay. We'll work on that. Still trying to work on Harry Potter, too, but she's not going there. The music. You'll hear some more music in just a minute. And this is, we're going to wrap this up. But before you on the front 3 rows is 111 freshmen that have joined the Spirit of Northwestern, the best sounding band in the land. See, a lot of you may not know this, and it's not debatable, that the best collegiate band in the United States is at Northwestern State University. Yeah. By the way, this is a speaking tip. You play to the crowd that's right in front of you, because, man, they really respond, right? Ingratiate yourself every chance you get. But they're really that good, and you'll hear them practice and you'll hear them play. It's one of the great things about being a Northwestern State University student. You're going to hear them play the fight song at the end. And the whole stage party will be here for the first time through the fight song, and then we'll leave at the end. But that fight song captures the spirit of being a Northwestern State University demon. September 3rd, this is the one cheer that you have to remember, okay? Because you have to say it September 3rd at the Inferno when we play this little team out of Hammond, Louisiana, right? And it's during the fight song, and the cheer is real simple. It says, beat the hell out of SLU, right? Y'all can remember that? Guys, throw yourself into this experience. This football team is going to be absolutely amazing this year, or at least they're going to give you reason to be proud because of their effort. You're going to see... If you went to the soccer game this last Friday, you saw us beat this little school in Alexandria 4-1. We've got a phenomenal women's soccer team. Volleyball is about to get started. The defending Southland Conference volleyball team is going to get started. The defending Southland Conference champion women's basketball team is going to get started. The men's basketball team, that this is not debatable, has the number one assist leader in the nation of any level, the number two scorer. It's the finest backcourt that exists in the game of basketball today. They're going to be great. The defending Southland Conference champion Lady Demons softball team will start in the spring. The men's team, they're good, and they're going to do great. The defending Southland Conference women's tennis team, right? If you're into sports, this is a place to be. If you're not into sports, they're great to go to because you get to commune with your fellow students. You get to see alumni act crazy and lose their dignity. You get to participate in the collegiate experience. And that's why we play the fight song, and that's why we believe the fight song. But before we play the fight song, you're going to hear probably the most important song that we sing here, and that's our alma mater, right? It's the most beautiful song that is played on this campus. And it talks about a watchword. That watchword is loyalty. Now, I'm making a commitment to you, and I want you to make a commitment to me. There's nobody in this room that cannot graduate from Northwestern State University. You can do it. You're expected to do it. Be loyal to yourself and do what's necessary to graduate. My commitment to you is that every person at this university that serves you is committed to your success and will be loyal to you until the day you walk across that stage in Prather and we hand you your diploma. Folks, there's no reason in 2019, while that press release doesn't come from Jerry Pierce's office, that says that Northwestern State University has the highest graduation rate in the state of Louisiana. There's no reason it shouldn't happen, right? We're going to do what it takes, you do what it takes, so that you become one of us amongst the 85,000 alumni of Northwestern State University, and remember that word, that watchword that governs over all of us, loyalty. Thank you all very much. You can rise for the alma mater. Fork 'em, Demons.
The words to the alma mater are on the back, or the inside of your program, as well as displayed up here on the screen.